Patlabor on television to the new files are entries in the franchise I am frankly surprised to see a lot of people skip out on. I believe it contains some of the funniest and most interesting episodes, though it contains one of my favorite sagas and arcs in the anime, the Griffon arc. The Griffon arc is probably the most important arc to Patlabor on television, and I mean, it is the central conflict that spanned several episodes. Though I think the conflict is probably the best one in the franchise. Yes, even over the movies. But exactly why is it so important? Why does it matter to Patlabor so much? In on television, most of the anime up until around the 30 episode mark was largely self-contained. Though this excludes the Phantom arc of the Schaft saga, which was episode 10 to 11 and 20 to 21 respectively. I've mentioned in a previous video that on television was meant to end after the Phantom arc, being on television's big and serious showdown. This mysterious labor called the Phantom, that was capable of shooting beams that pierced through labor armor and shot down aircrafts. It was even a little unsettling at times. The skull-shaped face with the false eyes that act as beam cannons probably would be an unnerving sight. Not to mention how it went unmanned. It was committing these acts under no human influences. This thing tried to kill people. Its defeat was a pretty big deal. It came from the waters of the bay and even attracted the attention of the JGSDF on both occasions. Noah would finally defeat the Phantom with the help of Asuma in Ingram Unit 3, bringing its story to an end. Due to the desire to extend the episode count, this arc would be more or less groundwork for something much, much bigger. On television would soon adapt an arc of the manga that already had some similarities on its own from the fighting with the Brockens deal. Therefore, precaution was taken, introducing a key character before the events would play out, Takeo Kumagami. Kumagami was an already established character in the manga, carrying the role many attribute to Kanaka. It's a shame too because of how many people assume she was nothing more than a replacement. No, she is her own character. No offense to Kanaka, but I find Kumagami a lot more of a compelling character as well. Soon we'd see bits and pieces of the Griffon itself being teased as time went on, with the man named Utsumi who worked in Schaft Enterprises Planning Section 7 being the manager of the operation. He was pretty much Kurosaki's boss as well, the man who was carrying out the whole Phantom operation too. He was a whimsical and jolly man who was almost always smiling and positive, but he was also intelligent as well. He at first started the Griffon project to see how strong they could push the limits of a labor, then deciding to sell the development staff to anyone who would invest. The first time we see the Griffon in action is when it's doing some covert operations against the JGSDF, appearing as a black streak in the night, tearing through a Samson as if it was made of butter. It then knocked down Helldivers in giving the most disrespectful finger to Fuwa. I mean, this thing is insane. Given this, to test out the capabilities further, Utsumi set its sights out onto the police. For the members of SV2 were getting ready to do security at the Tokyo Labor Show, an expo to show off new labors. There were talks of Shinohara Heavy Industries developing a new cost-efficient Ingram, being the economy Ingram that was shown off at the labor show. It looked promising, but that can only be proved on a field test, something Asuma believed when he decided to go on a test run himself. Oda tells him to exit the labor, saying that he's abandoning his position, and Asuma teases him in response. Had there been no build-up or whatever for this moment, we'd expect it to be some kind of goofy little scuffle. But instead, they were interrupted by a third party. A large truck with a container that pulled onto the scene and emitted some kind of gas. This is where the Griffon finally makes its appearance to Division 2, immediately ripping off the head of Machine 2 and throwing it at the Economy Ingram. Asuma tries to confront the Griffon, but the shortcomings of the Economy Ingram were unfortunately made very apparent in this fight. The response time was too slow. The entire lower half of the labor was shaking, it was unstable. I'd say that Asuma's skill was the only thing allowing him to last this long. Oda tries to intervene, but the Griffon uses the helpless Economy Ingram as a shield. It was a complete mess. Noah tried to pilot Machine 1, but remember that Asuma was using her movement disc. She was unable to assist in the apprehension of the mysterious black labor. After the economy model was down, Asuma came out injured from the fight. He handed back the movement disc to Noah, and the Griffon defeats Machine 2 afterwards. The Griffon tries to take his movement disc, but Oda was far too resilient to let that ever happen. Noah got Machine 1 and tried to confront the Griffon herself. As this was happening, Kumagami was clearing the area of passerbyers. Finding a car near the area, she tells them they need to leave, but she recognizes Utsumi as Richard Wong, a man she had romantic relations with back in Hong Kong. Before they can exchange words, Utsumi's chauffeur shoots her in the abdomen and drives off. This makes Utsumi demand why he shot her, but he said that it was too dangerous for Kumigami to have recognized him. Utsumi tells Bud that it's time to leave. Right as Noah gets in position to confront the Griffon, it stops, and a faint sound could be heard. Its wings flipped up, hanging in the air. It felt like an eternity for Division 2 as they were thinking, it shouldn't, no, it couldn't. Then, it happens. The Griffon takes off, jet blast blowing back the Ingram as it almost gracefully soars through the air. Everyone could only look on as what previously thought impossible happened. In the early days of OVA, Noah asked about the possibility of Libra's flying, with Asuma saying that it wouldn't happen for years. The build-up for the flight of the Griffon is similar to the build-up of the first firing of the Phantom's ionizing beam cannon, both instances of Libra's doing something almost unthinkable. The introduction was perfect, and it was a far worse debacle than the first encounter with the Phantom. With the Phantom, they at least had some kind of fighting chance. The key players were all there. Even the Helldivers were there for assistance with the Brockens. Here, the Griffon came at the most inconvenient time for everyone in the equation. It arrived when Osmo was in the economy model, something inferior to the Ingram, and felt the consequences of fighting such an advanced labor in it. Noah could only helplessly watch as Osmo had her movement disc. Oda's main camera was taken up before he could realize what's going on. Even then, it didn't take long for him to go down too. Kumagami had the misfortune of recognizing Utsumi, leading her to get shot and bleed out on the ground as the Griffon took off before Noah could even do anything. The economy model was shown to be insufficient in performance, embarrassing the development team too, I bet. At this point, everyone could only just watch. The Griffon would be a shift in a somewhat positive and upbeat tone of On Television to be more anxious and serious. Soon after, it'd be suggested that the Griffon crashed somewhere in the mountains, being destroyed by the impact and leaving a sense of a hollow victory for everyone at SV2. Noah especially would be affected, blaming herself for the inability to help anyone during their first encounter. She also believes that the fact that she was relieved to hear the crash of the Griffon means she was just a pathetic person. Oda gives Noah a surprise pep talk, something one wouldn't expect of him. He said that how he didn't expect her to help at all, saying how it was all Asuma's fault anyway. So long as she could recognize her problem, she was already on the path of making up for him. While Ulta may be a gun nut and an oaf, he's a pretty good guy at heart. Of course, she was happy to see that Asuma was okay too. Meanwhile, Utsumi was ready to pack up the Griffon project, as per orders by his boss. However, Bud convinces him that there's still a chance to continue, it wasn't game over. While Utsumi did change his mind, there were still concerns about 3S. Their name being Schaft Security Systems, they're a private military subsidiary of Schaft Enterprises arriving in Tokyo to make sure the Griffon project is put to a stop and retrieve the Griffon. And according to Kanaka, who just came back, their endeavors end up pretty bloody. Utsumi and Kurosaki plan to depart to Tokyo. However, they're intercepted by security. They pretend to head back to the office, though Kurosaki distracts one of them by suddenly dropping his briefcase and elbowing one of them. The two begin to push their way through and run off, with Kurosaki aiming his gun at them. They peel out of the building and the carriers heading for Tokyo, as 3S is hot on their tail. As this is all happening, SV2 hears about how the Griffon crash was faked, with Noah preparing herself for a future encounter with the Griffon once more. They would then learn that the Griffon would appear once again at the castle gate, an artificial island next to two other artificial islands. They would prepare a new, powerful weapon called the Riot Cannon, which was basically a giant labor shotgun. It's pretty cool. Utsumi would also have Bud ready up, connecting himself to the Asura and giving Griffon a thumbs up. Then, 3S2 would get their M5 Abrahams ready for combat. Now, all key players were in position. We haven't seen anything like this before on television. And not only was this coming out as a large conflict, but soon a personal one. Utsumi, Kurosaki, and the Griffon would be spotted by 3S arriving at the harbor by boat. Immediately, the Griffon decapitates an Abraham and tears its arm clean off. 3S quickly realizes that this labor means business. The whole thing will be broadcasted on live television too. No top secret behind the scenes stuff here. What would happen on this night would be known to everyone in Tokyo, even those who couldn't be there to see it. SV2 made their way to the artificial island as the Abrahams attempted to close in on the Griffon. Bud did not want to waste time fighting with them. Instead, he wanted to fight the Ingram. They tried to pull off some kind of jet stream attack, though they were missing their third and got bodied completely. Osmo watches as Noah finally confronts the Griffon, wanting to be there too and not just sit there and watch. Shinobu would decline to bring him along when Division 1 prepared to dispatch. Although Sakaki would bring Osmo along anyways, because the mechanics were bringing batteries along to the scene. The Ingram and Griffon stare each other down, anticipating one of them to make the first move. Then suddenly, Momoko and her crew speed their way to the battle, wanting to get some good coverage for themselves. The Griffon starts moving and Noah gets ready to fire. However, due to Momoko's crew standing right next to the Griffon, she was unable to. So instead, she strikes the Griffon with the riot cannon, causing it to fire off. This is the first time we see this thing being used, and it's terrifying. In contrast to the revolver cannon that is supposed to fire one shot per rotation, this one fires many pellets constantly. As this is happening, Utsumi and Kurosaki disguise themselves as Shaft's personnel, fooling the other three S members as they go looking for them. Oda persuades Momoko's crew to leave, and Noah is finally cleared to fire. Unfortunately, there is another obstruction, and Abraham attempts to plant a bomb onto the Griffon, causing Noah to hesitate to fire. She fired too late. The Griffon dodges and the shot hits the Abraham, completely obliterating its leg. The Griffon tries to charge Noah, though the bomb it was holding explodes, knocking the two out. While Noah is unconscious, she thinks back on when she played basketball, not doing too well, though she asked herself then, did she do her best? Osmo wakes her from her unconsciousness and tells her to fight. At first she's annoyed at his abrasiveness, but then realizes that he cares a lot upon hearing that she's hurt. The fight continues on, with the Griffon landing blow after blow. Oda attempts to assist Noah by capping the Griffon in the face with a revolver cannon, fired from the squad car with Hiromi. They somehow manage to hit the Griffon, and this is the first and only instance in the franchise when a laborer's head is hit by a revolver cannon shot, and it not being destroyed completely. At that point, there was nothing left of the fight. No clash of ideals, no standing up against evil. It was just a slugfest between a girl who wanted to run away and a boy who just wanted to win. This is probably the most brutal fight in the franchise, if I'm to be honest. The Griffon was something that they barely knew about, and Noah was forced to fend off against it in any way she could. It didn't look as if this thing had any weaknesses. It was powerful on all fronts. It was a terrifying enemy. Thankfully for Noah, the fight would end soon, as Utsumi calls her bud to abandon the fight. The Griffon could not operate much longer. As Noah goes in for another blow, the Griffon jettisons its arm and prepares to take off. She tries to grab its other arm, but it jettisons that as well, blasting off from the battle just like the labor show. The Griffon ends up not having enough speed to take off, and then it crashes into the bay. There the Ingram stood, bruised and battered. It tilted over, collapsing as the cockpit hatch pops off and bounces across the ground. Osmo runs to the Ingram to see the condition that Noah was in, seeing her in a fetal position.
イングラムは頑丈だよな。ハルミで乗ったエコノミーなんてさ、ひとたまりもなかったけどな。私はさ、こいつと一緒に逃げ出したいの我慢して戦い抜いたのに。お前にアルフォンスとその根性があれば何度やったっていい勝負ができるさ。いい勝負じゃダメだ。そうだな。
The scene itself says a lot about Noah and her character. I love it a lot. While not exactly clear as to why Noah values her job as a labor pilot, the scene shows us what exactly aren't the reasons. She wasn't there to stand up against any kind of abuse of power or some grand evil scheme, anything like that. this encounter was completely pointless. She wanted to run away. She was involved in the plans of someone she doesn't even know, and it was her responsibility to deal with something that not even military-grade labors could handle. She didn't want to prove anything. She never wanted a good fight, as she says. In the world of Patlabor, there are almost no good fights. After that night, Noah goes back to get some well-needed rest. Utsumi takes Bud to the airport to depart from Tokyo, running into Goto but evading his suspicion. The last several episodes have most definitely been a change of pace and tone for on television, grounding this entry in the franchise and making it one of the best. This especially has worked wonders for Noah's character. This new perspective on her is something you wouldn't get from the OVA movies. Seeing the happy-go-lucky tomboy mecha pilot shaken to her core by an encounter like this, this had to be different for the fans watching back then during the original run. The arc as a whole was amazing. After the Griffon arc, on television would go back to doing its own thing, self-contained stories now featuring Kumagami from the manga. Most likely thanks to the introduction of the Griffon, we would get another manga-adapted story, this time featuring the plotline of Noah having doubts about her capability as a labor pilot. This too did help out when it came to further characterizing her, along with the future anime-only episodes that push her development. Patlabor the New Files would be the sequel series to on television, giving the Griffon arc a proper conclusion. Utsumi returns to Tokyo, this time planning on selling the development team of the Griffon to investors, using its next battles as a showcase of strength. Division 2 would deliberately be distracted by another dispatch, with Division's 1 new Peacemaker units being deployed to apprehend the Black Labor, which has now appeared for a third time. When they arrive, for a moment, they do seem to be able to keep up with the Griffon. However, as Bud states, they don't know how to use their speed. The Griffon basically toys with them until they get a decent upper hand for a small window of time, though this is immediately made irrelevant. The Griffon was already too strong for the Peacemakers, but things will get worse when Utsumi would figure out the flaw of its operating system. The Peacemakers utilize a neural network system that helps with labor movement as a whole, being able to prevent collateral damage in battle. This will be used against the Peacemakers, as Gomioka is unable to attack because the Griffon has its back to a wall. From then on, that spelled the end for Division 1's new labors. The next episode, we'd see Division 2 pretty much in their last moments of clarity before they'd confront the Griffon again. Matsui would be investing the investors as they moved, with Utsumi planning the next match with the Griffon. We would also see implications of Kumagami recounting her past with Utsumi, something that was pretty vital when trying to trail the guy. Soon enough, Division 2 would be given the dispatch order to fight the Griffon once and for all. Kanika would also return right before leaving to America with her grandmother after listening in on the news broadcast. Funnily enough, Momoko once again rushes to the scene to broadcast the event, and get information on it like last time. Though soon she'd provide more than you think. Machine 1 and 2 would sandwich the Griffon on a bridge, believing that they finally have it cornered. Let's not forget, the Griffon is extremely fast, running full speed towards Oda, dodging the round from the riot cannon and disappearing into the water. Oda fires wildly into the water and into the bridge, before the Griffon would drag him down into the deep dark depths of the water below. The Griffon would then flee the scene once more, giving Division 2 some time to recuperate. Kanika arrives to the station, wanting to somehow contribute to the ongoing battle, though there aren't any working Ingrams available. Kanika suggests that they appropriate parts from the Zero and make a more complete version of the Ingram Unit 3. Sagaki obliges and they get to work. The Griffon deploys again and is spotted going to Harumi, yet the Ingram isn't done charging. They resort to charging it on their way to the location, hopefully having enough power to sustain another confrontation. They'd see the Griffon's Aqua Unit swimming through the water, with Noah trying to land a shot onto it. Asuma realizes that it's a decoy and warns Noah, but it's too late. The Griffon already ambushes her. Momoko and Kumagami would be using the recording equipment to spy on a nearby building filled with these labor enthusiasts. They'd get a good view on it, even managing to spot Utsumi amongst the others. The Griffon would continue its harsh attack on the Ingram as its battery drains slowly, though it suddenly stops, backs up, and gets low to the ground. What the Griffon does here incites the same shock value it did when it first took off. Ready? Ah! The scene was amazing. No one could figure out what the brand new trick this machine had up its sleeve this time was. Noah could only sit and let it happen, because at that point, there was no escape. This thing was fast and terrifying, and the police had to find some way to deal with how unpredictable it could be. The Ingram was knocked onto the carrier, nearly out of power. The Griffon was closing in to deliver the final blow. Hiromi then floors it, causing the Griffon to miss. As they get away, Shinji drives the second carrier to delay the Griffon from catching up with them. Shinji almost gets killed trying to do this. Even he thought he was going to die. Just as the Griffon nearly catches back up with them, a third carrier arrives with Ingram Unit 3 aboard. And Kanaka confronts the Griffon, holding it off pretty well. Kumagami gets ready to confront Utsumi as this is happening, believing that she had found the correct hotel room. Although upon entry, it seems as if it was just some random couple spending the New Year's together. Kanaka does her best against the Griffon, but not even she is skilled enough to fight against such a powerful labor. Unit 3's arm is severed clean off, then being knocked down on the ground. Noah comes to her aid in Unit 1, but Kanaka is already trying to shoot at the Griffon. Noah stops her, saying that this isn't America and she just can't start firing at targets like this. Utsumi is intercepted by Kumagami, who then apologizes for all the things he had done. He asks to be turned in, explaining what had happened after he left her in Hong Kong as he empties the bullets from a magazine of his handgun. He explains that he truly did not wish for her to be caught up in his endeavors with Shaft. She cuffs him, but Utsumi surprisingly gives her a loving embrace. While Kumagami's in a flustered state, he then suddenly bridal carries her and dumps her into a bin. He escapes into an elevator, but not before telling her that he really did love her. The Ingram and the Griffon are once again engaged in brutal combat, not too dissimilar from their fight at the castle gate. Her cockpit door breaks off, and the Griffon delivers a knee right inside, nearly killing her. This only served to piss her off even more. Kanaka tries to intervene, but Noah tells her off. She delivers a powerful hook into the Griffon's head, then performs an entire suplex, causing both machines to fly up and crash down hard onto the pavement. Using this to her advantage, she opens up the cockpit door of the Griffon and, at gunpoint, tells Bud to get out. This scene was great. This was a far cry from the past Noah we've seen at the beginning and at the fight at the harbor. She was determined to finish this fight. This was something personal, something that she just had to finish. Not just for the safety of the others, but for herself. The suplex itself almost reflects how much she had grown when she was beating herself up over her failed apprehension of the Griffon during her first encounter, unable to successfully down Ota when they were sparring. She managed to overcome an opponent much stronger than her through pure determination. Utsumi and Kurosaki escape, leaving Bud and the whole Shaft thing behind. Utsumi takes out a detonator that he previously said didn't work. Kurosaki questions this, but he said he just lied. Back at the scene, the pilot seat of the Griffon suddenly ejects. Asuma checks out the inside and discovers a bomb was planted inside of the Griffon. Kanaka grabs the labor and drags it into the bay, with the both of them falling over the side and the Griffon causing a massive explosion. However, Ingram Unit 3 simply just fell on the shoreline. Kanaka had survived, and thus was the end of the Griffon. Life goes back to normal at SV2. We hear that Bud was extradited back to India and Shaft Enterprises would do some downsizing as a result. Kumagami decides to give away a watch, most likely belonging to Utsumi originally. This was probably an attempt to let go of her past with Richard Wong. Then, that would be the end of the entire saga of the Griffon, which was most definitely the best and probably the most important aspect of On Television and of New Files. I've mentioned before that the development of Noah's character benefited greatly, and the atmosphere set by its arrival was perfect. Now, you could say that the Phantom achieved somewhat of the same things, but I would disagree. The Phantom appeared one day. It was another mysterious labor that went around causing trouble for the police and the JGSDF. But in the end, it was another case of a rogue military-grade labor. On the other hand, the Griffon had the build-up and infamy that would stay with Section 2 as a whole. It too appeared suddenly, but its presence actively affected the mindset and morale of the police, even when it wasn't even there. Look at these two images side by side. This is the same character beginning to end. I did say that the fight at the castle gate was pointless, but I wasn't saying the fight didn't have meaning. It was a pointless fight for Noah's involvement. Utsumi nor Bud didn't want to fight her. They wanted to fight the Ingram. She was only involved because she was its pilot, and she didn't even want to fight it either. However, the fight gave us a view into Noah's character, someone who had no reason to fight such an important battle, now given the reason to continue on. Unlike the Phantom, no one else was there to bail her out of the situation. She had to fight to the end. Even then, the fight ended on an inconclusive note, and it got away. The next time she fought the Griffon, I like to believe that she wanted to deliver some kind of retribution, or some way of making up for the last fight. It's almost a full-scale, all-out brawl again, only held back by the draining energy of the Ingram. Sure, she saved a few times in the fight, but when the Ingram is falling apart in the moment, and she nearly dies in the midst of combat, she perseveres. She had come a long way. Here and now, she was able to see the proper conclusion of the battle itself and the personal struggle against the Griffon. The entire saga of the Griffon was just legendary. It breaks my heart again to see people skip out on television and the new files, missing out on such amazing storytelling and some of the best in Patlabor, I'd say. If you made it this far, thanks for listening. Putting this video together took a lot of time. If you want to see more, like, comment, and subscribe. But with that being said, thanks for watching, and I hope you see it.